what used to be called leaky gut is now called endotoxemia. That is, so the entry of that endotoxin through the intestinal wall, leaky gut, into the bloodstream, endotoxemia. But that's how you can experience all those brain, skin, muscle, joint effects from gut microbes. What increases the permeability or the gut leakiness? An excess of fecal microbes. Fecal microbes colonize the upper GI tract. That's easy, more easily penetrable. Other things that we've mentioned, emulsifying agents that dissolve the mucus barrier. Lack of butyrate, that nutrient that comes from feeding microbes with things like inulin. So there's a whole long list of things that increase. And wheat, the gliadin protein of wheat also is, with good science, we know increases gut permeability. So, and by the way, combine SIBO with wheat consumption, that's a lethal combination that leads to inflammation, weight gain, autoimmune diseases, et cetera. So you can see it's a whole different way of looking at disease. Now, colon cancer, there's some really cool stuff coming out in colon cancer. So colon cancer is clearly a disease of colonic dysbiosis, not of SIBO, because it's in the colon, but colonic dysbiosis, but probably proliferation of certain species. But some of the most exciting in science is this. There's a microbe in the mouth called Fusobacterium nucleatum. So most people have a little bit of it, but it's harmless in small numbers. But if you have bleeding gums, like when you floss, or gingivitis, or periodontitis, the number of Fusobacterium goes sky high. And then it enters the bloodstream, not through swallowing, but enters the bloodstream and colonizes the colon. And the evidence is getting very good. That is a major cause of colon cancer. If you take that microbe, put it in a normal mouse colon, it gets colon cancer. If you examine a sample of colon cancer taken out of a person, it's filled with high counts of Fusobacterium. If you look at metastatic lesions, like in the liver or lung, in colon cancer, it's filled with Fusobacterium. Now, there's preliminary evidence. You eliminate Fusobacterium, and you may even get remission of the colon cancer. But it's an example of a relatively newly recognized phenomenon called translocation. A microbe here, for instance, in the mouth, colonized the colon, which is remarkable when you think about it. Likewise, if a woman takes that Lactobacillus crispatus probiotic for vaginal dysbiosis, well, she's going to take it as an oral probiotic, but it's going to colonize the vagina. Well, how did it get there? There's no connection. There's contiguity. They're near each other in the what's called the perineum, the groin area, but there's no direct connection. Even more remarkably, that crispatus colonizes the bladder, the urinary bladder that we all thought for years and years was sterile. No, it colonized the bladder. And there's very good evidence from Loyola University that it cuts urinary tract infections, repeated urinary tract infections by half, by 50%. So another example of this newly recognized phenomenon called translocation. Microbes escape the GI tract or mouth and go to other places. There's a microbe in the mouth called Porphyromonas gingivalis. You can find it in the brain in people with dementia. Now, is that causative or just an accompaniment? No, nobody knows. To prove it, we'd have to say, let's get 1,000 people or so. Let's give them more Porphyromonas, see if they get dementia. Not going to do that, right? So that evidence is somewhat preliminary, but it's becoming very interesting. If you went to your doctor and said, I think I have SIBO, and I think my psoriasis is from the endotoxemia of SIBO, doctor will say, did you consult Dr. Google again? Or there's nothing wrong with you? Or don't waste my time? Or there's no such thing, even though there's thousands of research studies documenting all this stuff. But because it takes a generation for the practitioner to catch up to the science, they won't know about these things. If you're lucky enough to have, say, a gastroenterologist who does know something about SIBO or SIFO, they'll typically hand you a prescription for that antibiotic, rifaximin or xifaxan. Very costly, side effects, about 50 to 60% effective. And then you'll come back with recurrences because it loves to recur. Another prescription for antibiotic, and over and over and over. And each time you get sicker and sicker and sicker because you're ruining your microbiome. Making that SIBO yogurt, having people make that SIBO yogurt. So recall, those three species and strains colonized the upper GI tract where SIBO occurs, and they were chosen because they produce these bacteriocins. The gasseri, for instance, Lactobacillus gasseri, the BNR17 strain, produces up to 7 bacteriocins, natural antibiotics effective in killing fecal microbes like E. coli and Salmonella. And so far, fingers crossed, it has worked remarkably well.